All right, Saagar, what's on your radar?
Well, Joe Biden has certainly kept his promise. Under him, we are going back to normal. And one of the worst signs of that is beginning to materialize. As I've kept you all up to speed here, the White House is facing a monumental choice. The Trump administration negotiated a deal with the Taliban in Afghanistan. All U.S. troops had to be pulled out by May 1st. The terms of the deal stipulate that the Afghan government must work with the Taliban to integrate them peaceably into their democratic governance. A problem from the beginning has been that the Afghans don't want to do that. They want American troops to stay forever because we pay their bills. And by their and the U.S. commander's admission, they literally would not be able to defend themselves against the Taliban or anyone, really, without us. All of this has paved the unholy alliance between the Afghans and the Pentagon. The Pentagon wants to stay. They're mounting a full court press, manufacturing consent effort as to why saying all of our work on women's rights should be for naught if we left. Or that without us, the Afghans can't do the job. Therefore, we have to stay. As I've said, this is ridiculous, given that we have spent nearly $100 billion on the Afghan National Security Forces, and after nearly 20 years, we still don't have squat to show for it. All of the media efforts and Pentagon campaigns that I spotted weeks ago have come to bear because the worst news I've heard on the war front in quite some time came out over the weekend. Two people, quote unquote, familiar with the matter, told NBC News Biden is weighing keeping U.S. troops in Afghanistan until November, which comes around the exact same time that he told ABC News in a recent interview it would be, quote, tough for the U.S. to meet the May 1st deadline to withdraw troops. Remember the warning I gave here last week. If Joe Biden does not withdraw U.S. troops on May 1st, I am 100% convinced they will never leave. And it seems that despite his long experience, that Joe Biden has just been rolled by the Pentagon like Barack Obama and Donald Trump before him. The logic within the NBC News story is cartoonishly similar to the things I've heard from two administrations so far. Quote, Biden has pushed back against the Department of Defense efforts to keep U.S. troops in Afghanistan beyond May 1st, one of the people said. But he has been persuaded to consider a six-month extension. 6 months! One of his advisors told NBC News, quote, Biden wants out, but said that Pentagon leaders have been making the case that the Taliban isn't living up to its end of the agreement, describing the argument as, look, you own this now, Mr. President. We can't guarantee you what will happen if we just precipitously pull everyone out. There it is. It officially got rolled. Pentagon does this every single time. When Barack Obama came into office in 2009, they told him he would own the Afghan war, that he had to send hundreds of thousands more troops, and when he and Biden demurred, they strategically leaked stories about how he was endangering U.S. national security. He ended up agreeing to the surge, it completely failed, thousands of U.S. troops and Afghans died, nothing changed. Then Donald Trump came into office. He said, I want to get out of Afghanistan. The Pentagon said, no, sir. The problem is that Obama tied our hands behind our backs. Give us the right rules of engagement. We'll wrap this thing up within a year. Couple thousand more troops. Okie doke, he said. Yep. Guess what happened? Taliban control, more ground than ever. But what's really crazy is how brazen the Pentagon is in their lies to successive American presidents. Trump also fell for this while in office, when he was adamant U.S. troops had to get out of Syria. They told him, oh, sir, just 6 more months and everything will be solved. He said, okay, that sounds reasonable. Then 6 months go by. He says publicly, we're getting out of Syria. What happens? The Pentagon loses its mind, leaks against him, pushes back, defies orders, gives every reason why they can't leave. It's all fake. 6 months is their equivalent of an airline telling you the delayed takeoff time is just 30 minutes away. You need evidence? Look no further than Biden's own Secretary of Defense. Retired four-star General Lloyd Austin just stopped over in Afghanistan a few days ago to say, quote, it's obvious that the level of violence remains pretty high in the country, Mr. Austin said. We'd really like to see that violence come down, and I think if it does come down, it can begin to set the conditions for some really fruitful diplomatic work. Asked specifically about a departure date, he said, quote, what we want to see is a responsible end to this conflict. Again, let's go through this logic. We can't leave until the violence goes down. The violence is happening because we are there. The only way to end the war is through diplomacy, but diplomacy can't happen until the violence goes down. It's a dizzyingly stupid, but it's the exact same argument American officials have been making now for two decades. It's not time to start talking until the violence goes down. Then the violence goes up, and now the violence is the problem. Not the lack of talking, which is actually the only thing that will end the violence. 6 months is a fantasy. The war will never end under these conditions. All of this is a six-month extension in life for the Afghan government, their corrupt apparatus, the thousands of contractors who make billions of dollars off of our presence there, and everyone else who has a vested interest in this war. If you want the most stark evidence that exists of a permanent national security state in Washington, you need look no further than this story. The last three presidents of the United States have sat in the same chair, in the same room, and been told the same lies. And all three of them have fallen for them, despite being democratically elected, literally, to do the opposite. The result is destruction and chaos for our service members, while a select group here in Washington are getting filthy rich. And it's crazy to me, the six-month thing. It always comes back, and they fall forward every time, and they use the same arguments. I saw it on Trump, just six more months, and because he was new here, he believed them. He was like, oh, yeah. And this is the thing. Biden sat in the room when the Pentagon's lied to Obama's face, and he said, don't listen to him, Mr. President. Don't do it. And then he did. He witnessed it. He was there on Libya, and he saw that all fall apart. He was there for Iraq, and he saw that all fall apart. The guy gets in the same damn chair and believes, hears the same lies, which he called lies at the time, and he listens. What more evidence do you need? How is anybody supposed to get out of this war?
Well, and he also knows what tools they'll wield against him.
Oh, yeah. They'll destroy you.
If he goes against their will. I mean, what does any reasonable person think is going to be different in 6 months than it is now?
Yeah, it's been 4 years.
At least with Trump, they had, like, some sort of a case they could make. Oh, the rules of engagement. Yeah, they just need to free us up to
it's
do our
fake.
Thing. And no, well, like, it'll all be fine. As you point out, like, that was a complete lie. It wasn't the problem. Taliban controls now more territory than ever. Now they don't even have a story. Like, what is the story that they're telling him about what's going to change in 6 months or 6 months from then or 6 months after that? Nothing is going to change. It is status quo. And it's just about people who want to keep making their money or preserve their ability to make money in the private sector after they get out of their public service posts. That's what it's all about. It's incredible, though, when you lay out the timeline of just how many times the same line has been fed over and over and over and over again, and how they buy it every single time. And again, I think it's partly because they are swayed by whatever propaganda they're being presented, and I think it's partly out of fear of being smeared to the press and having leaks against them, that they're soft on national security and all of that, which can destroy presidency.
Yeah, and look, like the twisted logic there is what gets me. The violence is too high. Violence there is lower than ever against U.S. troops. You know why? Because we have a peace deal with the Taliban. So he says we need the violence to go down. Here's what's going to happen. If we keep those troops after May 1st, then the Taliban is going to say, screw you. They're going to start attacking U.S. troops again. And now the violence is going to go up. And then force protection becomes the issue. So what's going to happen? Well, we have a lot more attacks against U.S. troops. Mr. President, you got to send 1,000 more troops there in order to protect the troops that we already got. And so then the violence can come down. And then American troops can come home. What did I just describe? The last 20 years of American policy in Afghanistan. All of the violence stems from the fact that we support a government which is not seen as legitimate in the eyes of like a third of the population or under the Taliban. Yes, are they tyrannical, terrible Islamists? Yes, they're awful. Many of them have smiled while killing American troops. But this is the thing. How do you have peace? You shake hands with your enemies. It's a terrible thing. But after 20 years, what is worth the continued presence in Afghanistan? And it's like I said, it's the same lies over and over and over again. And they all seem to fall for it. And they all fall for it in the first months of their presidency.
Yeah.
Trump came in, probably one of the most committed presidents ever, at least rhetorically, to saying, we are going to end this. And they convince him to send more troops to Afghanistan. I'm convinced the same thing will probably happen here. And Lloyd Austin and all these guys, this is the problem with picking a general as your Secretary of Defense. This guy is personal friends and colleagues with the commanders who he's now seen as overseeing. He came up in this system of their thinking. How is he supposed to present different options to the President of the United States? You need somebody completely outside of the system to say, no, I think you're full of shit. And that was Biden's thing. not even that long ago. That's right. Actually the most galling part of it all.
Well, it's also worth noting that Democrats have aggressively courted the like neocon, yeah, never Trump wing worse. Of the Republican right. Party. And they're now a key part of the sort of Democratic base and intelligentsia. And I think that piece bears talking about as well. And the type of figures who've been lionizing cable news, that stuff influence. Look, these people who are in these key positions, they actually watch what's happening there and they listen to those people. And so the fact that that coalition has been subsumed into the Democratic Party doesn't help matters either.
It really doesn't. And yeah, go turn on the channel and see if they're talking about this right now. All right. I'm looking forward to your radar next, Crystal.